This is your free service teacher for today's episode. I am Shaneen Carbo. So for today, we will tackle on assessing non-cognitive disposition and skills, specifically the attitude. So attitudes are internal states and beliefs that vary from positive to negative in reaction to an object, situation, issue, activity, person, group of objects or person, or environment. So people have different reaction to things like jobs, life, partners, neighborhoods, and events, and those reactions influence their attitude towards the subject. So attitude is consists of three elements or contributing factors. First is an affective component of positive or negative feelings. So it consists of the emotion or feelings associated with an object or a person. So it is connected to the idea that it affects someone else. So it deals with feelings or emotions that are brought to the surface about something such as fear or hate. So for example, someone might have the attitude that they love all babies because they are cute, or that they hate smoking because it is harmful to health. So the next one is the cognitive component describing worth or value. So it is an evaluative belief. So attitudes are shaped by our ideas, beliefs, and qualities about objects. So it represents one type of attitude, an opinion or viewpoint. So it pertains to that part of a person's attitude that has connection to his broad knowledge. So typically, this comes to life in generalities or stereotypes. So such as kind of all babies are cute, or smoking is harmful to health, and etc. The next one is the behavioral component, indicating a willingness to engage in specific action or the response. So behavior component of an attitude consists of a person's tendencies to behave in a particular way toward an object. So it refers to that part of attitude which reflects the intention of a person in short run or long run. So using the above example, the behavioral attitude may be, I cannot wait to kiss the baby, or we better keep those smokers out of the library, or and etc. So those are the elements or the contributing factors of attitude. So now we will go to the examples that would assess attitude. So how do one assess a non-cognitive disposition and skill? So we could learn about people's attitude by just simply asking them. But that's not the case. How people feel about themselves is strongly linked to their social acceptance. So the measuring of attitude is usually broken down into two categories. A process called direct measurement, where semantic differential is used, and an indirect process called indirect measurement, the projective techniques. So the semantic differential technique of Osgood et al. Asked a person to rate an issue topic on a standard set of bipolar adjectives, so each representing a 7-point scale. So to prepare a semantic differential scale, you must first think of a number or words with opposite meaning that are applicable to describing the subject of a test. So for example, participants are given a word, for example, car, so and represented with a variety of adjectives to describe it. So respondents take to indicate how they feel about what is being measured. So in here, in semantic differential, we can see if a person's feelings or its evaluation towards an object is consistent with their behavior. So an attitude scale is designed to provide a valid or accurate measure of an individual's social attitude. However, as anyone who has ever faked an attitude scale knows, there are shortcomings in the self-report scales of attitude. So there are various problems that affect the validity of attitude scales. However, the most common problem is that of social desirability. Socially desirability refers to the tendency for people to give socially desirable to the questionnaire items. So people are often motivated to give replies that make them appear well-adjusted, open-minded, and democratic. So self-report scales that measure attitude towards race, religion, sex, etc. are heavily affected by socially desirability bias. So now, we will move on to the projective techniques. So to avoid the problem of social desirability, various indirect measures of attitudes have been used. So either people are unaware of what is being measured, which has ethical problems, or they are unable consciously to affect what is being measured. So indirect methods typically involve the use of a projective test. So a projective test involves presenting a person with an ambiguous or incomplete stimulus. So the stimulus requires interpretation from the person. Therefore, a person's attitude is inferred from their interpretation of the ambiguous or incomplete stimulus. So the assumption about these measurements of attitude is that the person will project or his or her views, opinions, or attitude into the ambiguous situation. So thus, revealing the attitudes the person holds. However, indirect method only provide general information and do not offer a precise measurement of attitude strength, since it is qualitative rather than quantitative. So this method of attitude measurement is not objective or scientific, which is a big criticism. So examples of projective techniques include thematic perception test, that is it taps into a person's unconscious mind to reveal the repressed aspect of their personality. So a projective test is one which a taker responds to or provide ambiguous, abstract, or abstracted stimuli, often in the form of pictures or drawings. So how do we evaluate indirect method? The major criticism of indirect method is their lack of objectivity. Such methods are unscientific and do not objectively measure attitudes in the same way as a Likert scale. So there is also the ethical problem of deception, as often the person does not know that their attitude is actually being studied when using indirect methods. So the advantages of such indirect techniques of attitude measure are that they are less likely to produce socially desirable responses. The person is unlikely to guess what is being measured, and behavior should be natural and reliable. So that is how we assess non-cognitive disposition, especially the attitude. So furthermore, even if our attitudes and beliefs are shaped by external influences, we still have control over many of our internal influences. When it comes to our behavior, our emotion, and our ideas, we can control. What we can control is totally dependent on us and not on our external circumstances. So that would be all for this episode. I hope you have learned something. And if you do, please leave a comment, like, share, and subscribe!